Hey, good morning.
Merry Christmas.
Why don't y'all sing with us?
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world, we will sing, sing, sing.
Erase.
Joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs implore, while fields and floods, rocks, hills, and plains repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat the sounding joy. We will sing, sing, sing. Joy to the love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love. We will sing, sing, sing. Joy to the
the theme of heaven.
life has come, look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us.
Emmanuel, art the head.
righteousness, light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. While he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Glory to
Chapel fam, we're glad that you're joining us on this awesome Christmas day. So Merry Christmas to everybody who's a part of the Chapel family and anybody who may be joining us online. We want to greet you. We're glad you're with us. We hope you're celebrating and having a great day with friends and family. And we want to take this time to open up God's Word, as is appropriate on Christmas Day, to celebrate and take part in our last message in this series on a covenant Christmas. So if you don't mind, watch your bow. Let's all pray together as we always do every time we open up God's Word together. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity for us to gather in homes and with family and with friends across many different places right now. And Father, we believe that you are the author of your word, that you've inspired it by your Holy Spirit. And we pray that in this time, that your Holy Spirit would fall upon each person listening, in each room, in each living room, in each house. And Father, that you would be the one who would enlighten us, that you would be the one who would teach us your word, that you would give us a deeper knowledge of yourself in a way that would draw us closer to you and result in more fruit in our lives. And we confess that this is only possible through the abiding power of your Holy Spirit. Be with us in this time. Be glorified in this manner of worship. It's in the name of Christ we pray all these things. Amen. All right, if you want a title for our message today, we're going to call this one simply The New Covenant in Christ. And before we get into some new territory, I want to take you back to somewhere that we've been recently in the book of Mark. And we've made reference to it a couple of times as we've tried to ask God to give us a greater understanding of his grace, the heart of grace that God the Father and God the Son demonstrated for us, and that we would understand the grace of God in a much deeper way even than we have before. And one of the ways that we provoked that thought process was through that idea of Peter. Peter, who was the rock upon which Christ said that he would build the church. And yet, as a part of Peter's testimony, he had that time when Christ had prophesied that he would deny Jesus as his Lord and Savior. And we saw that actually happen in real time as we walked through the book of Mark. And there was that scene that was set up for us in the Gospels where when Peter denied Christ for the third time and the rooster crowed, and in that nighttime trial of Jesus, he looks and through a crowd of people and over whatever that span of distance was, Peter and Jesus Christ lock eyes. They make eye contact with one another. And I asked you to think a little bit about that. I asked you to think, what if it was you? What if you and your failures? What if you and your shame? What if you and all of the struggles that we all share in the human condition? What if you made eye contact with Christ? What would you see in his eyes? What would his heart be towards you? And we talked about that a lot. We had conversations about that in small groups and at coffee shops, sharing a cup of coffee and over lunch and in all kinds of places and all kinds of things. And we were all provoked to think about what that heart of Christ would be towards us. As a matter of fact, I don't want us to miss it in the book of Mark. We saw in Jesus, we saw him put his hand on the leper and heal. We saw him cast out demons. We saw him minister to the poor, the sick, the hurting, the desperate. He fed the hungry. He set the captives free. He even went to the greatest religious people, the most religious people, and he met with them as they had need. And he revealed his heart of compassion to each of those people as he's revealed it to us as well. Now, as a staff right now, we're reading a book. And essentially, the content of the book is about the gentle and lowly, compassionate heart of Christ towards us. And I want to remind you that Jesus Christ is the exact manifestation, the exact representation of the heart of God in the flesh. So when we see Jesus reach out to others, when we see Jesus put his hands on the leper, when we see Jesus set the captives free, when we see Jesus become the person who's known as the friend of sinners, then he's demonstrating something to us of the nature of the heart of God. The heart of the Father towards us demonstrated in the actions of the Son. And I want us to think about that. And I want us to think about this simple phrase that I'm going to share with you right now. I'm going to share it now, and I'm going to share it at the end of this short time we have together today. And that is this, that the nature of God is to step closer to the sinner and the sufferer. And again, that's a thought from the book. That's not an original thought from my own mind or heart. I want you to understand that. But it's a provoking thought that I've been meditating on and we've been discussing as a staff. The idea, again, that the heart of God, the nature of God, is to step toward the sinner and the sufferer, not away from them. And I want you to see that in the counsel of God's word. I want you to see it from beginning to end. We're going to start this morning in the book of Genesis in chapter 3. Now remember, in Genesis 3, we have the fall. We have the first sin by Adam and Eve. And that sin is separating them from God. But in the context of Genesis 3, I want you to start to see the heart of God for his people, for his created people who are created in his image. And so I'm going to read you just a couple of verses out of Genesis 3. First, in Genesis 3, verse 8, and it says, they being Adam and Eve, after their sin, they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. Now, we can all understand this. In our sin, we want to isolate ourselves from God. We want to run away from God because of our guilt and our shame. But that's not the part I want you to focus on. The part I want you to understand is that God shows up in the garden, even knowing their sin, because he's omnipotent. He knows all things. But this was his manner of life with his created people. He walked in the garden with them. He spent time with them. He had intimate, deep relationship with them. And he doesn't run away from them in their moment of sin. He goes back into the garden, as is his custom, to spend time with them. And it goes much further than that. In verse 21, it says, the Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. Garments of skin. Now, what's required to make a garment of skin? Very simply, what's required is a sacrifice. This was the first atoning sacrifice that was ever made in history. And God made it for his people to cover them, to cover their sin and their shame, as he steps towards them in their sin, as he steps towards them in their guilt, as he steps towards them in his suffering. And this is the nature of the heart of God. And you're going to see it all through the scriptures. Now, I want you to keep in mind, from this point, from the time in the garden, now we see a legacy of failure among God's created people. You start with Adam and Eve. They walked in perfect relationship with God in essentially what was a perfect, sinless creation. And yet they fell. They chose to disobey God's commands, and they chose to commit willful sin. And then you go to the very next chapter in Genesis 4, and you've got Cain and Abel, and you have one brother murdering another over his jealousy. And as you continue to move on, you go to the book of Exodus, and you have the people of Israel wandering around in the wilderness, not willing to take and to receive the great inheritance that God had promised them in the land if they would just go in, and if they would be strong and courageous and overcome their fears. And yet they choose to grumble and complain about their leadership, about what may be required, and they get stuck in the wilderness. And then you go on through much of the Old Testament. You go into the period of the judges that we taught about years ago at this point in time. And you see that all the people were set on doing what was right in their own eyes. And that over and over again, no matter how many times God answered their cries and delivered them, they always went back to doing what was right in their own eyes in their unfaithfulness. And then we come to the book that I'm going to share from you right now with this idea of a new covenant. And you see, this new covenant is presented to us and prophesied to us in the middle of a book that contains much of the wrath of God for the sins of his people, his unfaithful people. And you're going to see that in these verses. I'm going to read to you from Jeremiah 31, starting in verse 31. And it says this: "Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah." Now, I know we've already been talking about covenant for weeks, but y'all know me. I can't not talk about it. And the simplest definition for the Hebrew word for covenant is to cut. And essentially what it kind of implies, the meaning it carries with it, is to cut flesh and to pass between the pieces of flesh, which is this visual illustration of the covenant God made with Abraham back in Genesis chapter 15. But essentially, that's what a covenant is. It's to cut. It demonstrates to a sacrifice. And I want you to understand and pay attention to who's making the covenant in this passage. Because remember, we have this Old Testament history of the people of Israel being unfaithful to God over and over and over again, committing adultery and sin against God over and over again. And yet, who is making this covenant, even with the unfaithfulness of the people that we've seen? Verse 32. "Not like the covenant which I made with their fathers in the day I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, my covenant which they broke, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. But this is the covenant which I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and on their heart I will write it, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. They will not teach again each man his neighbor and each man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they will all know me. From the least of them to the greatest of them, declares the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and their sin. I will remember no more." God is the one who is moving towards his people. He is the one who is making the covenant. This is not God's people begging for him to come back into relationship with them. This is God intervening on their behalf, as he has over and over and over again. He says, "I will make a covenant, though you have been unfaithful with me." And he invokes this idea of like a marriage. And the idea that he says is that you have been an adulterous people. You have betrayed me. You have turned your backs on me. You have broken this intimate relationship that we have established together, that I have established with you. And yet, I will make a new covenant with you. So the question has to be at that point, how is it that God could make this new covenant with his people? Not the covenant which he made with his people in Egypt, not the Mosaic covenant, not the covenant of the law, but a new covenant where he will write his laws upon their hearts and he will be their God and they will be his people. Well, let me remind you, what is a covenant? It is to cut. It's to cut what? It's to cut flesh. It's a sacrificial atonement that brings into deep relationship. And that brings us squarely to the Christmas story. Matthew chapter 1, starting in verse 18, says this: "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child by the Holy Spirit. And Joseph, her husband, being a righteous man and not wanting to disgrace her, planned to send her away secretly. But when he had considered this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, 'Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child who has been conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.' Now all this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet: 'Behold, the virgin shall be with child and shall bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel,' which translated means 'God with us.'" How could God make the new covenant with his people? It had to be through a sacrifice of flesh. It had to be through a cutting of covenant. And the cutting of that covenant was through the child Jesus. You see, this was the significance of the birth of Jesus Christ that we celebrate on Christmas Day. The new covenant cannot come unless God has sent his son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. The sacrifice was provided on Christmas. Glory to God for the birth of his son, demonstrating to us again that God was intervening on behalf of his people, that he was stepping into, not away from, our sin and our shame and our guilt and our fear and everything that we battle with in this human condition. He came to intervene in that condition and to accomplish this new covenant and writing his laws upon our hearts. It goes even further. It becomes even more intimate. We go into 1 Corinthians 6:19, and it says, "Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you?" You see, Jesus came, was born on Christmas, right? But then he left. After his death, after his burial, after his resurrection, he left and he told us to wait upon the one I will send you. Wait upon the coming of the Holy Spirit. And we realize now, according to Ephesians 1, that when we believe in the name of Jesus Christ, when we trust in him for the salvation, for our salvation from our sins, that we are sealed in him by the Holy Spirit of God for our redemption. Do you know what that means? Do you know what that means? That means that when we look at the book of Mark and when we see the leper and when we see the poor and when we see the crippled and the lame and the blind and all of those that Jesus healed, it means that when the Holy Spirit indwells us, that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, with the heart of God's compassion for all of us, is closer to us today than he was even to those that he touched with his physical body when he was here on earth. Again, that's another thought from Dane Ortlund in this book that we've been reading, that he's closer to us now. Now, we don't think of Jesus in that way. We think of him being high and exalted and lofty and set apart and far away from us. And I get all those things because he is holy, holy, holy. His ways are greater than our ways. He is unsearchable. The riches of his greatness, his goodness, his power, his mercy, his compassion, his love, they are unsearchable for us. But yet he is also the God who is in this strange way attainable and approachable. And not even is he approachable, he desires and approaches us that we may have deep relationship with him. Why? Because his heart is compassion. His heart is love. He steps towards the sinner and the sufferer, not away from them. And again, I told you I wanted to show you this idea throughout the whole Bible, from Genesis, where he still walked in the garden and even gave a sacrifice of flesh for Adam and Eve right after their sin, that allowed sin to come into and enter the world and stain it in the way that sin does and destroy it. I showed it to you in Jeremiah, that in the midst of the punishment of God's people for their spiritual adultery that resulted in the Babylonian captivity, and yet he gives this prophecy of a new covenant in which he will fill us with his spirit and write his laws upon our hearts, replace the heart of stone with a heart of flesh. And then we see it in the birth of Jesus, where God steps into human history with being fully God and fully man in the birth of Jesus Christ, demonstrating again, stepping further towards us. And then Jesus leaves and sends back the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts so that he is with us, residing in us continually. And then you go to the very end of the story. You go to Revelation 21, starting in verse 3, and it says this: "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them, and he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain. The first things have passed away.'" Now, when that passage says there will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain, what is mourning? Well, mourning is, yes, the sense of loss, death, destruction, the results of sin in our world and even in our very lives. But mourning also has another context, and that is the sorrow that comes from committing sin. the guilt, the desire to change things, to have never made those decisions that hurt the heart of God. But God says in Revelation 21, there will no longer be any of those things. You see, Matthew, Revelation 21 is a restoration of the peace and intimacy with God that Adam and Eve experienced in the garden before sin stained the world. And that's where we're going to. That's where we're heading to. That is what the journey that God is taking us on in our sin and our struggle, confessing our sin and asking to be forgiven through the one atoning sacrifice, which is Jesus Christ, so that we may be reconciled or made friends with God again. And yet, this reconciliation, as great as it is and as close as Jesus is with us through the presence of his Holy Spirit, this is our final redemption. No sin, no struggle, no suffering, no pain, no more mourning, no crying, no hunger, no separation. God among his people. In the beginning, it was God among his people. In the end, it will be God among his people. And right now, in the midst of this time, in this place, even in all of the struggle, it's God in and among his people. And that's what the birth of Christ represents for us on Christmas Day, the coming of the new covenant, the birth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let that be the good news that we celebrate on this Christmas Day. Not just the gifts, not just the family, not just the food. All those things are great blessings from the Father's hands. But the greatest gift is the good news of the gospel and the birth of Jesus Christ. Let's pray together and ask that God would impress that upon every one of us. Father God, would you do exactly that? Would you remind us that this is your heart, that your desire and that your heart of compassion demonstrates to us, not according to the words of man, but according to your actions and your words across all of history past, across the present, and across history even in the future, Father, is that your desire is to have an intimate relationship with us. Would you remind each and every one of us, no matter where we find ourselves today, and no matter what we are struggling with, even if things are not going well, if circumstances seem to be set against us, if we are struggling even in our battle against sin, will you remind us today that your heart and your nature and your desire is to step towards the sinner and the sufferer? And Father God, my prayer for each one of us is that in return, that we would understand that you are accessible, and not only accessible, but desirous, and that we would not run away from you or isolate from you in our sin and our shame, but we would step towards you, that we would receive forgiveness, that we would walk in love, and that you would fill us with your power so that we can walk more and more in conformity with the image of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father. We pray all these things in the name of Christ. Amen. Merry Christmas, Chapel family. Let's all worship God through all of our actions today on Christmas Day.
Light of the world, treasure of heaven, brilliant like the stars in the wintry sky. Joy of the Father leads through the darkness, shine across the earth, bring the shadows to light. Light of the world, from the beginning, the tragedies of time were no match for your saw my story. God, you entered in and became one of us. Sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah for the things he has done. Down before him, sing.
that he paid.
Glory and there.